Introduction to Semantics in the Brain. The study of semantics in the brain is a branch of psycholinguistics that incorporates the understanding of semantics and the neurological structures that are involved. It attempts to answer the unanswered question of how objects and concepts are represented and processed in the human brain, Nopany, Price, Penny, Friston, 2006. This field of study has received an enormous amount of research because, in essence, semantics is what allows us to verbalize and express ourselves about the people, places, and things in our lives. It is essential to human communication and exists within all human beings across languages. Although widely studied, understanding the neurological side of semantics is highly controversial. Researchers agree that the inferior frontal, figure 1A, inferior parietal, figure 1B, and temporal cortex, figure 1C, are all involved in processing semantic memory. However, the exact involvement of the specific areas is not necessarily agreed upon. Visser, Jeffries and Lambin-Rappel, 2010, distributed networks. Although it has been widely accepted that the left hemisphere has a higher association with language than the right hemisphere, the specific areas of activation have been a continued source of debate. Recent research has identified distinctive regions of the left lateral prefrontal cortex and the anterior temporal cortex that are associated with object processing, Martin and Chow, 2001. More specifically, the area of activation depends on characteristics such as the object's form, movement, and uniqueness. In regards to object form, studies have shown that images such as faces, animals, and landmarks produce a greater activation in the lateral fusiform gyrus and the right superior temporal sulcus, both of which are close to areas that mediate object motion. In contrast, when shown images of man-made tools, there was a greater activation in the medial fusiform gyrus, the left middle temporal gyrus, inferior temporal sulcus, and left ventral premotor cortex, coincidentally near the region associated with object manipulation. Although the specific study entailed the participants naming or viewing the object, the same areas show greater activation when the participant imagined the object or answered questions about the objects, Martin and Chow, 2001. In agreement with object form, object movement pertains to distinctive neurological networks that correspond to the motor-related regions, Martin and Chow, 2001. For example, there is a greater level of activation in the left ventral premotor cortex when participants name tools rather than animals. Like the object form, this is also true when participants view pictures of tools and animals. Due to the limited availability of research upon patients with left premotor lesions, it is unknown if the left ventral premotor cortex is needed for naming and retrieving information that is related to object movements such as tools, Martin and Chow, 2001. The study of object form and movement both examine generic items. Studies such as Gauthier, Anderson, Tarr, Skidlarsky and Gore, 1997, examined the difference in activation when objects are unique rather than generic. For example, is there a difference in neurological activation when shown a picture of your dog Rudy, compared to a random Siberian husky? The answer is yes. The anterior regions of the temporal lobes show higher activation when the object is unique and differentiable to the individual, see figure 2. There are several theories as to why unique items show higher activation in the anterior region of the temporal lobes. One commonly accepted assumption is that objects are organized hierarchically, with more generic objects being represented first in the posterior and specific unique items being represented in the anterior, Martin and Chow, 2001. It is important to note that although distinct areas have been reported for higher levels of activation, this does not mean that other areas are not also highly activated. There is considerable overlapping among activation within the ventral cortex, Martin and Chow, 2001. The examples provided here demonstrate the distribution of neurological networks in regards to semantic memory and provide the basis for future research. Neural network hub. Within recent years, the thought of semantic memory deriving from a central hub has been widely debated. The term semantic hub or neural network hub refers to the anterior temporal lobe, ATL, which acts as a semantic hub, combining information from different sensory and motor areas to form amygdal semantic representation, Visser, Jeffries and Lambin-Rappel, 2010. Researchers such as Lambin-Rappel, Pabrick and Jeffries, 2009, agree with the notion of the semantic hub, whereas others such as Martin, 2007, do not place a great deal of significance on the ATLs. In 2010, a meta-analysis was conducted by Visser et al. To examine the differences in the methodologies between studies that support the significance of the ATLs in comparison to those that do not. Using predetermined criteria such as imaging modality, field of view, FOV, size, stimulus type, and the magnitude of the semantic task, 164 experimental studies were examined. The results showed significant differences among all criteria. Studies that were conducted using positron emission tomography, PET, scans, had a significantly greater activation in the ATL when compared to functional magnetic resonance imaging, fMRI, scans, Visser et al. 2010. In addition, recent fMRI scans, studies conducted between 2004 to 2008, had a higher rate of ATL activation than fMRI scans studies which were conducted between 1999 to 2003. Visser et al. 2010, suggest that this may be due to technological improvements in fMRIs, methodological improvements, or the use of more auditory stimuli, which are known to show higher ATL activation. Whole brain coverage was operationally defined as having an FOV of 15 cm or greater, Visser et al. 2010. Although only 22 of the studies within the meta-analysis displayed whole brain coverage, those that did were more likely to report ATL activation. This is a possible factor that may have inhibited the remaining studies with a smaller FOV to miss ATL activation. Similarly, studies that documented the ATL as a region of interest, ROI, reported higher rates of ATL activation. This means that due to a lack of ROI, ATL activation may have been overlooked or unnoticed due to insensitive neuroimaging studies, Visser et al. 2010. The type of stimulation used across the studies varied from pictures, words, to sentences. In agreement with previous research, Rogalski, 2009, greater ATL activation was recorded when the participants were presented with auditory sentences rather than pictures or words, Visser et al. 2010. The notion of the semantic hub remains debatable, however, meta-analyses such as Visser et al. 2010 have provided an insight as to the possible methodological differences that may account for the difference within ATL activation during semantic neuroimaging studies. Models of semantic memory. The hierarchical network model. Collins and Quillian developed the hierarchical network model in 1969. This model of semantic memory is based on the principle known as the cognitive economy, Conrad, 1972. Cognitive economy implies that knowledge about concepts is only stored once, so it is not repeated throughout memory, Conrad, 1972. For example, the concept that cats have tails is stored within the definition of a cat, therefore specific details such as a ragdoll cat has a tail, and a Maine Coon cat also has a tail do not need to be stored, Collins and Quillian, 2004. Collins and Quillian's model can be visualized using a hierarchical structure. At the top of structure are general concepts with more specific details on the lower levels of the structure, Collins and Quillian, 2004. Figure 3 illustrates the cognitive economy principle, with the examples of canaries having wings and sharks being able to swim. The spreading activation model. The spreading activation model was developed by Collins and Loftus in 1975. As with the hierarchical network model, the purpose of this model was to demonstrate how words are accessed within in mental lexicon, Collins and Loftus, 1975. According to the spreading activation model, concepts are connected via nodes, and the strength of the connection is represented by the distance between the nodes. For example, the concept of a fire engine may have a strong connection to ambulance and fire, which is represented visually with a short distance between the nodes. Whereas, fire engine may have a weaker connection to the words street and vehicle, which is represented with a larger distance between the nodes, see Figure 4, Collins and Loftus, 1975. Although the spreading activation model is more advanced than the earlier hierarchical network model, 1972, it does not include all aspects of lexical access, such as the phonological, syntactic and morphological characteristics of word, Levelt, 1989. Semantic priming. Semantic priming is the unintentional increase in speed or accuracy when responding to a stimulus such as a word or a picture. It occurs when a prime word is shown before a target word, McNamara, 2005. For example, the prime word may be nurse, and the target word may be doctor. Many studies, such as the lexical decision task, incorporate semantic priming. In a lexical decision task, the participant is shown a prime word with a specific stimulus onset asynchrony, SOA, such as 500 milliseconds, then the prime word is removed, and a target word is shown. The participant then must decide if the target word is a real word or a pseudo word, such as Bempel. Studies have shown that when the participant is shown a prime word that is semantically related to the target word, the participant's reaction time decreases. Other uses of semantic priming include cognitive tasks, and in the study of perception and cognition, McNamara, 2005. Loss of semantic memory. The loss of semantic memory can result from a number of different factors. However, there are four generally accepted categories: Alzheimer's disease, herpes simplex encephalitis, severe head injury with localized effects, and semantic dementia. Below we will briefly examine each category. Alzheimer's disease. Alzheimer's disease is commonly associated with the loss of memory, due purely to its higher rate of prevalence. Alzheimer's disease is the most common cause of dementia affected 1 in 8 Americans, Hebert, Scher, Beanias, Bennett and Evans, 2003. According to the Alzheimer's Association of America, it is estimated that an American develops Alzheimer's disease every 70 seconds, Alzheimer's Association, 2010. Dementia of Alzheimer's type, DAT, usually begins with the loss of episodic memory, autobiographically events, Patterson and Hodges, 1995. As the damage spreads into the bilateral posterior association cortices, such as the lateral temporal structures, semantic memory is affected. As the disease progresses, the damage within the semantic memory increases, becoming more easily detectable, Patterson and Hodges, 1995. Herpes simplex encephalitis. Simply defined, herpes simplex encephalitis, HSE, is inflammation of the brain caused by the herpes simplex virus type 1, the same virus that causes cold sores or blisters around the mouth, National Institute of Neurological Disorders and Stroke, 2004. Although fairly uncommon, affected approximately 2 people per million a year, HSE can be fatal if untreated. During the critical phase, a patient with HSE will experience retrograde and anterograde amnesia of episode memory, Patterson and Hodges, 1995. This loss of memory is caused from damage to the medial temporal lobe and frontal lobe. The loss of semantic memory among patients with HSE is becoming more common. Within these patients, damage is usually seen in the temporal neocortical areas, Patterson and Hodges, 1995. Severe head injury. Head injuries are assessed objectively with the use of the Glasgow Coma Scale, GCS. Patients who receive a GCS rating of 8 or lower are classified as suffering from a severe head injury, Goldstein and Levin, 1995. Unfortunately, suffering from a severe closed head injury typically results in some form of anterograde amnesia. The duration of the memory loss can vary, however, studies have shown that the duration is positively correlated with severity, meaning that those who suffer a more severe injury will experience a greater loss of memory, Vilke, Poraputas and Servo, 1988. The long-term impacts of head injuries vary amongst individuals, however, issues such as impaired delayed recall, susceptibility to interference, contextual and source errors, as well as issues with semantic priming, are all fairly common. Studies, Crossan, Novak, Trenary and Craig, 1988, have shown that patients who suffer from severe head injuries are less likely to utilize semantic tactics, such as clustering and recategorizing. Although head injuries usually disrupt episodic memory, leaving semantic memory intact, there have been reports of impairment within semantic memory, Patterson and Hodges, 1995. For example, the case of patient MP, a young woman who was involved in a car accident, is an example of how severe head injuries can cause extensive damage to semantic memory, Patterson and Hodges, 1995. Semantic dementia. Formal thought disorder. Although schizophrenia only affects 1% of the general population, approximately 90% of those diagnosed with schizophrenia suffer from formal thought disorder, FTD, Asif et al. 2007. FTD is characterized by disorganized and incoherent speech. It has been described as loose associations, which are essentially two trains of thought or ideas that are combined into one incomprehensive statement. For example, the question, "Why do people believe in God?" may receive a response such as, "Because make a twirl in life, my box is broken, help me blue elephant. Isn't lettuce brave? I like electrons, hello." Doctor's Lounge, 2007. In 1979, the Thought, Language, and Communication Scale, TLC, was developed by Anderson to clinically diagnose patients with FTD. Using 18 items such as incoherence, blocking, echolalia, pressure of speech, and blocking, patients are rated on a point scale. With the use of the TLC scale, researchers have concluded that FTD is the result of impairments in semantic priming, Asif et al. 2007. Given the high prevalence rate surrounding FTD in patients diagnosed with schizophrenia and some patients with bipolar disorder, a great deal of research has examined FTD in semantic priming, Asif et al. 2007. As previously discussed, semantic priming research is conducted using lexicon decision tasks. Studies have shown that patients with FTD have an increased rate of semantic priming compared to schizophrenia patients without FTD and healthy control patients, Mantrick et al. 1988, as cited by Asif et al. 2007. This has led to the belief that those with FTD have an increased speed of activation, although other studies such as Barch and Berenbaum, 1996, have not been able to reproduce these results, Asif et al. 2007. When examining the neurological abnormalities associated with FTD, the research is inconclusive, Asif et al. 2007. Using positron emission tomography, PET, multiple studies have shown that FTD is positively correlated with an increased blood flow in the prefrontal areas, the left superior temporal sulcus, and the inferior parietal lobe. Specifically, the anterior prefrontal cortex, ACC, and the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, DLPFC, display overactivation in patients with FTD. At this time, it is clear that further research must be conducted to strengthen the far-spreading activation hypothesis.